Greetings, everyone, and welcome as we join together for worship. This weekend is Transfiguration Sunday. This is the famous story of Jesus takes his inner circle of disciples. They go up on the mountain, and the disciples are able to have an experience with Jesus, Moses, and Elijah together. So we're going to talk about that today in the message and reflect on that, the meaning of this story for today. And we're glad to have all of you here with us, no matter when or where or how you're watching this. We hope that this service will be a blessing to you and that you'll keep tuning in. Let us now prepare ourselves for worship by joining in the confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out upon all people, whose goodness cascades over all creation. Let us now confess our sin, trusting in the abundant grace of God. Holy God, you search us and know us. You are acquainted with all our ways. We confess that our hearts are burdened by sin, by our own sins and the broken systems that bind us. We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love. We distrust those who are not like us. We exploit the earth and its resources and fail to consider generations to come. Forgive us, gracious God, for what we have done and left undone. Even before the words are on our tongues, you know them. Receive them in your divine mercy. Amen. How vast is God's grace! Through the power and promise of Christ Jesus, our sins are washed away, and we are claimed as God's own beloved. Indeed, we are forgiven. In the wake of God's forgiveness, we are called to be the beloved community, living out Christ's justice and the Spirit's reconciling peace. Amen. We will now have our opening hymn. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. hymn of praise is Glory to God. Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, the resplendent light of your truth shines from the mountaintop and into our hearts. Transfigure us by your beloved Son, and illumine the world with your image. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We will now have the readings.
The first reading is from 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. Today's reading centers on the transfer of power and authority from the prophet Elijah to Elisha. Their travels, which retrace the path of Joshua back to Moab, the place where Moses died, and the parting of the waters, demonstrating that Elisha and Elijah are legitimate successors of the great prophet Moses. Here is the reading. Now when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives, as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. A company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Elisha said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came into Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know. Be silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jordan." And he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them, as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other, until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Please let me inherit a double share of your spirit." He responded, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet, if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted to you. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them. Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them into pieces. The psalm for today is Psalm 50, verses 1 through 6. The Mighty One, God the Lord, has spoken, calling the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting. Out of Zion, perfect in its beauty, God shines forth glory. Our God will come and will not keep silent, with a consuming flame before and rounding about of raging storm. God calls the heavens and the earth from above to witness the judgment of the people. Gather before my loyal fathers those who have made a covenant with me and sealed it with sacrifice. The heavens declare the righteousness of God's cause, for it is God who is judge. The second reading is from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 3 through 6. The spotlight of Christian ministry is not on the people who carry out the ministry, but the Lord Jesus Christ. Just as God made the light shine at creation, God makes the light of Jesus Christ shine in our lives through Christian ministry. Here's the reading. Even if our gospel is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbeliever to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, whom is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves. We proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and ourselves as slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, "Let the light shine out of darkness," who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Here ends the readings.
We continue now with the gospel verse. Gospel according to St. Mark, the 9th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. But then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my Son, the Beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. And as they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we hear today the story of a mountaintop experience. Lord, we thank you for all the mountaintop experiences we have in our own lives, those moments when we can really feel your energy, your presence, your joy. But Lord, help us to remember that the story is not just about meeting you up on the mountain, but it's about how you come down and meet us where we are. We pray, O Lord, that as we meditate and reflect on your word, that it will speak to us in a new way, and that whenever we leave worship and we go back into our lives, we'll be able to share your love, your energy, your joy with all those who are hurting. We ask this in Jesus' name, amen. A businessman who was well known for his ruthlessness once announced to author Mark Twain, "Before I die, I'm going to make a pilgrimage to the Holy Land. I will climb Mount Sinai, and I'm going to read the Ten Commandments from the top of that mountain." "I have a better idea," replied Twain. "You could stay in Boston and keep them." Mark Twain was not particularly a man of faith, but he was very witty, and he had a lot of good insights. I mean, after all, don't all of us wish to have mountaintop experiences? I am one who's never been afraid of heights. Some of my fondest memories as a kid are going to Chicago and going up the Sears Tower. I think now it's called the Willis Tower. But we would go up to the 110th floor, where you could see into Indiana and Michigan and Wisconsin. It was really, really impressive. That is, you could see on a clear day all these states. I love that view. And then they had it so that you could actually walk out. They had some kind of a special glass where you're actually away from the building, but you could look down and see how far it was. Of course, that didn't bother me. I loved it. And then I'll always remember a trip I was able to take with my family to the Rocky Mountains. I got to go to a 2-week course called the Academy of the Rockies. And even though we were 8,000 feet above sea level and had to adjust to the air there, when we were able to spend days in the mountains, it was absolutely breathtaking. Unbelievable. When I looked around, I was in such awe that it just reminded me, all these mountains could not have been created by accident. There's a creator behind it all. I really felt the presence of God when I was up in these mountains. And then about 7 years ago, I had the opportunity to go to the Holy Land. It was a very, very powerful experience. Because I was able to go to the places where Jesus was and walk where he walked, such as you see a picture here of the Sea of Galilee. Now when I read the stories, I can picture it right in front of me. And we got to take a boat ride on the Sea of Galilee, where Jesus spent so much of his time. It was breathtaking. And then we got to see Bethlehem as well, where he was born. And there was a beautiful view of Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives. You could look down over the old city. It was absolutely breathtaking. But yet there's one moment, however, that particularly stands out in my memory. The very last place that we visited in our trip was a location called the Skull Hill in the Garden Tomb. Some believe this was the actual place where Jesus was crucified and buried. I mean, there's no way of knowing for sure. I mean, majority of Christians believe the true place is the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, a building which was built over the supposed tomb of Jesus. But yet, regardless, going to there and actually seeing what looked like on the hill the face of a skull, and imagining the cross right under it, and seeing the tomb, this ancient tomb, it really looked real. It felt real. It was really, really powerful. You could actually picture Jesus' death and resurrection by being there. But actually, the most powerful experience, though, was right at the end of our time. After we toured the tomb and the Skull Hill, we had a communion service together. And at the service, we all gathered, and the bishop who was with us started leading communion, and I assisted him. But what was particularly moving was that It was an experience that really helped us all to bond. And I must admit, there was one couple I was with. There were about 20 of us on this trip. One couple kind of drove me nuts the whole trip. Let's just say we were at odds in our views, especially politically. And they would make cracks throughout the whole trip that I didn't appreciate, but I managed to keep my mouth shut the whole time. So this couple that was driving me nuts the whole trip, you know, ended up sitting by me when we had communion. But at that moment when we started to receive, it's like all barriers were broken down and we wept. We embraced each other. God broke down the barriers at that moment. Our group really bonded. Plus, it was emotional knowing that this was probably the last time we would ever see each other, since we all came from different parts of the country. Yeah, it was a great experience because we were in the Holy Land at the place maybe where he was crucified and buried, but what was more powerful was how God broke through the barriers of our differences in our relationships and bonded us together. Ultimately, it was about the relationships that were being built. Well, today is Transfiguration Sunday. This is the famous story of Jesus up on the mountain with Peter, James, and John. Wow, these guys really got a treat that no one else got to. And it was kind of like, for them, a Mount Rushmore experience. Any of you ever been to Mount Rushmore in the Black Hills of South Dakota? It's very, very impressive when you go there and see the figures of the former presidents, Washington and Lincoln and Jefferson and Roosevelt. That was impressive in and of itself, but yet the disciples got to see real figures, real alive figures. Moses and Elijah are brought back from the dead, and they're up with Jesus on the mountain. I mean, wow. What a mountaintop experience. Good old Peter. I love it when Peter opens his mouth, don't you? I mean, Peter doesn't know what to say. And, of course, Mark's commentary is interesting. After Peter says what he does, Mark adds the comment, he didn't know what to say. He says, why don't we stay up here? Let's build three booths. But then a voice comes down from heaven. This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him. Peter is humbled. But yet, can we really blame him? I mean, if we had that experience, we'd probably want to stay up there too, being at that holy place. But they all had to come back down from the mountain. And ultimately, they had to follow Jesus to the cross. The experience was not about meeting God up on the mountain. The experience was about Jesus being revealed as the one who was fulfilling the law and the prophets. He was fulfilling what Moses and Elijah and all the others had predicted. And Jesus was transfigured before them, which means he didn't change who he was. He just presented himself in a new way. He presented himself in a new way so that they could see who he really was. And they could see that eventually he will be reigning in glory. But so the purpose of the experience wasn't just for them to encounter God on the mountain. It was about identifying who Jesus is so that when they came down from the mountain, they will know that he will always be with them. So we can enjoy the mountaintop experiences that we have, like I had in Israel and the Rocky Mountains and so on. But what we need to realize is ultimately what's most important is how God is present with us in our relationships and in the people around us. Our triune God is a God of relationship. After all, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, again, is a loving relationship between the three persons. Our triune God is a God who meets us up in the mountains and as well as down in the valleys of our lives. This glorified Jesus on the mountain, who was there with Moses and Elijah, this glorious Jesus is the same Jesus who was the mocked, tortured, and crucified figure on the cross. This same Jesus, this Jesus of glory and suffering, is with us right now. On the mountain, Jesus showed himself in a different way so that we may know that he is the Son of God, the chosen one that we can trust in. And so perhaps today, God isn't showing himself in a different way, even in these times of pandemic. Even in these different times as we're being forced to worship differently and perhaps gather differently, we have the same loving, powerful God that he's always been. We have a God who is with us all, who brings us together. And we as a church are a work in progress through this. We continue to be a work in progress. But we continue to move forward, figuring out how to be church, how to worship and care for one another, as well as reach out to the community. In all these ways, whatever we're doing, whatever process we're going through, we can trust that our transfigured, our crucified and risen Lord is with us now. In some ways, we may feel like we're kind of in the doldrums. Things are kind of stagnant right now. For a while, the positivity rates seem to be going down, but now they've kind of gone up again, and there's worries about the variant. I mean, we're facing some uncertainty right now. But nonetheless, as a church, we keep moving forward because we are Christ's church. And even though things are tough, we know God is here with us now. He's with us when we're on the mountain, and he's with us now as we gather in whatever form as a community. Jesus is alive in the well and meets us where we are. We don't have to go up to find him. He comes and finds us. We do not know what the new normal will look like, but what we do know is that our crucified and risen Lord is with us through it all. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. We will now have our next hymn.
There's no space that his love can't reach. There's no place where we can't find peace. There's no end to amazing grace. Take me in with your arms spread wide. Take me in like an orphan child. Never let go. I am holding on to you. to you. In the middle of the storm, I'm holding on, I am. Holding on to you, I am. Holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I'm holding on, I am. In the middle
of the storm, I'm holding on, I am. We continue now with the prayers of intercession. In our prayers, we are lifting up Patty, who's recovering from COVID. She's June Steinberg's daughter. We lift her up, as well as Tina and Joan, Mardell, Cindy, Kathy, Helen, Jackie, Dawn, Gerald, Ginger, Anna, and Sam. And I'd like to again remind everyone that if you have a joy or concern, please feel to let Amy know in the office this week, or you can let me know as well, text or call or email me. We're here for each other. It's all about lifting each other up, so please do not hesitate to share any joys or concerns with us. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Gracious Lord, we thank you for the mountaintop experiences we have in our lives. But Lord, help us as we enjoy them to remember that when we go down into the valleys of our lives, you go down there with us as well. That your Son, who shined in glory on the mountain, is the same Son who suffered death on the cross. That this Son is with us now through the ups and downs of our lives today. Help us to remember, O Lord, that each and every day, you will never abandon us. You are with us always, even to the end of the age. And Lord, we lift up before you all those in need of healing in mind, body, or spirit, especially Patty, Tina, Joan, Mardell, Cindy, Kathy, Helen, Jackie, Dawn, Gerald, Ginger, Anna, Sam, and all others we name. And Lord, we lift up all public servants, and we especially lift up those who are sacrificing their lives for our country. We lift up Ryan, Shane, Chris, and Zachary, and all others. Lord, we thank you for all medical workers, especially those on the front lines battling COVID. We pray that you will bless the efforts of our government as we distribute vaccines. We pray that those who need them will get them. Lord, we thank you for all the science and for all the dedicated people who are working to help get people vaccinated, that we may all be safe. Lord, we pray for our schools. We pray for school administrators, teachers, staff, parents. We pray that our schools will continue to be patient as they find ways to keep everyone safe. Lord, we pray for our country during these times of division. Lord, we pray that our elected leaders will find ways to have common ground, to work together for the common good. And Lord, in our lives, we pray that you will help us to find ways to be peacemakers. Help us to love one another and be patient with one another as we all continue to endure this ongoing pandemic. Help us to show each other grace as you have and you always continue to show us grace. And Lord, as we begin our Lenten season, we ask a blessing on our Ash Wednesday service. We pray for a little warmer weather, but Lord, we know that you will be with us through it all. We pray that this Lenten season, as it will be different this year, will be a time of reflection and renewal. We ask that you guide us as a church as we They're a work in progress as we find ways to celebrate Lent. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now let us pray together using the words our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive the blessing. May God the Father strengthen you, Jesus the Beloved fill you, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter keep you in peace. Amen. Again, I'd like to thank everyone for joining us in worship. I'd like to thank everyone who helps put this worship together. All the musicians, our sound people, cameramen, readers. I appreciate everybody and the team effort. And as we continue to be a work in progress on worship, we're going to continue to try different things. We appreciate everybody's patience and support. So now, may all of us go forth in peace and be the light of Christ. Thanks be to God.
Reach out and touch.